I'm so glad that you are here to join us in today's chance to honor and tell the Spike Dykes story in a way that helps us walk through this loss. Before we begin, I want you to know that in your service order, there is a misprint, and that Glenn Austell, we are blessed to have Glenn here, who is the leader over Lubbock Young Life, and also a pastor in his own right, and also close to this family, both in ministry and as friends. So blessed to have him in the service today. We're on the brink of Resurrection Day, and we're here today to make sure we get that Easter is coming and that today is already about that. And we gather to grieve a big loss, but we also realize that that loss is a huge win. In fact, we gather to support this family and to join in with them in telling the Spike Dyke story today. And we gather to create ripples of faith that start right here and begin to spread those ripples across our connections, ripples of faith, love, and hope that are a part of who we are. So thank you for surrounding this family, and thank you for celebrating the life of Spike Dykes today. By the way, Coach Dykes has given us an order, and that order has come through the kids to me, that there will be no crying in the room. In fact, the order goes this way: if you cry, you gotta leave. And so our ushers are gonna be watching. We should have some penalty flags here for this. One of Spike's mantras that the kids shared with me was, "Don't feel sorry for me. I've got to cut the heart out of a watermelon." That means he doesn't want this to be a mournful time, that he wants this to be a celebration time. And we're not here just to obey him, but I do believe that that's going to be our best game today, to be able to celebrate who he is still in the life of this family, to celebrate who he is in all of his investment in each of you and in this community and in this whole area. So we want to cut into that watermelon today, taste that with him, and enjoy the icon that he has become in our lives, and put that together with faith. So seriously, this hour is a time to let our trust in God actually come together with our love and respect for Spike Dykes. Commingle so that we get to allow our faith to guide us through this grief and into celebration. We have people that aren't just in this room, but people in the overflow, people wherever you are. We want them to know that we want them to join us in this time to celebrate who Spike is. Let's pray together. God, we give thanks that the team of Spike and Sharon are together again. That resurrection brings high school sweethearts together this week. And that you are the best coach for us left behind for how to grieve, how to heal, how to celebrate, and how to get back in the game. So find us where we are and send us out today with a mission. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. There's a hymnal in front of you. If you're in an overflow area, this is my time to tell you, by the way, that you don't have a hymnal and you get to hum along. We didn't have enough hymnals to take to our overflow or to the USA. We're sorry, but you will know the hymns. Today we want you to stand together and sing these words of faith, "How Great Thou Art." Thank you.
Please be seated. Readings from God's Word, 2 Timothy chapter 4. For I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time has come for my departure. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. And from Philippians chapter 4, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put these things into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. The word of the Lord.
Thank you, Glenn. William Taylor Dykes, which is not a name that I've used before. And yet it feels good to be able to share that name and to fully give honor. He represents all of West Texas football players, because he was that player that grew up out here, and he became that college player that we football players aspired to. He became that coach in that small community that represents so many of those coaches in these small communities. He became that coach that worked his way up through the college ranks, and he represents so well, grinding out seasons, chasing recruits, saving moving boxes. You've read his story, and hopefully you have read his book. He came out of Ballinger with football skills and a sweetheart, two things. And both of those served him well through all of his years. His college work set up his coaching and teaching stops and at the high school level, which also set up his college coaching stops, which led to his coaching sweet spot we call Texas Tech University. Along the way, so many honors and recognitions, not the least of which were Southwest Conference Coach of the Year 3 times and the Big 12 Coach of the Year, and inducted into the Texas Tech Athletic Hall of Fame in 2001 and the Texas Sports Hall of Fame in 2008, and so many celebrated players. His overall record was 82-67-1. And amidst those W's, were an amazing, and can I say, extremely satisfying set of wins over UT and Texas A&M. Coach, I'm sorry. I'm not going to ask for an amen on that. We sat in this very sanctuary 6 and a half years ago, to remember Sharon, his amazing wife. This week's news was not expected, but Spike's health had become fragile over the last several months, and his loss leaves behind a great family that we all get to add to our prayer lists over the next months. The oldest, Rick, and his wife, Shelley, and their kids, Julianne and Jessica, Jessica's husband, Mark, and their two kids, Lucy and Swede. And then there's Dusty. Where did Dusty go? There he is. And then Bebe, the middle child, and her husband, Larry, and their kids, Casey and Taylor, married to Taylor. You heard that right. And their sweet little one, Towns. And then Sonny and Kate. And their three kids, Alta, named after her grandmother, and also Charlie and Daniel. Now you realize that that's the immediate family, but that Spike had a way of drawing you into family, right? And so it's not just this family and the extended family, but in some ways across the room there are multiple families. And so you're going to hear probably in what's to come about some of those families, like the Mullets and the Fishing Buddies and the Pebble Beach Buddies and his assistant coaches, and on the list goes. In fact, if you coached with Spike somewhere along the way, or you're a family member of that coach, because we've lost some, would you take a moment and just raise your hand? Awesome. Awesome. Amen. Amen. And if Spike coached you, let's turn that around. If Spike coached you somewhere along the way, wherever you're sitting, because I know we have a group here and we may have some in the overflow. If Spike coached you, would you take a moment and just raise your hand? Amen. Across the room. That's a neat moment. You folks were family to Spike and a huge part of his life investment. You understand that. Dr. Michael Fye and Leah Pierce get special recognition today for their care, both of Spike and of Sharon. And Spike, of course, was preceded in death by his lovely wife, Sharon. And today is a special day. Today, Sharon's birthday. So we come into the space where we celebrated her life, and we get to celebrate both of them. And I do believe not only are they reunited, but they're trying to celebrate with us. And I expect coaches probably seeing those of you who are crying right now. We are very blessed today to have some special guests to come and share some Spike Dyke stories. And so I'm going to call on coaches Doyle Parker and Anthony Lynn and Mac Brown to share a few words. Coaches, would you come?
As many of you know, we all fit in the same category, and someone probably asked most of you out there, do you know Spike Dykes? And most all of you, including myself, would say, know him, he's my best friend. So there's many of you out there that could tell stories like we're going to tell real shortly, better than I could, but I wanted to share a few of those. We go back, Spike and I go back to 1962. My West Texas arithmetic is correct. That's 55 years. He was an assistant coach at San Angelo Central. I was an assistant coach at Abilene Cooper. We competed against each other as assistant football and JV basketball. So we each thought we had all the answers at that time. And little do we know. But we just seemed to hit it off and became great friends, and it remained for 55 years. But there's some things that all of you know, and how much fun that he brought into our lives outside of football and the X's and O's and so forth. He brought so much joy and fun into our lives, and I'd just like to share a few of those stories with you. And most of the fun, I think, in my personal opinion, came from his mother, Alta. She loved to have fun. And I think that transferred down to William Taylor Spike Dykes. He was a few stories here. He loved to fish, especially in the Gulf Coast. And when he got the job at Alice, he called me. He said, "You got to come down here. We're going to go catch some trout and some redfish." He said, "I used my uncle's boat." Said, it's an older boat, but it'll be fine. I know where all the magic hot spots are. We're going to catch some fish." So I take my family down. 5 o'clock in the morning, we're up. We're headed toward Baffin Bay. We get the boat. We back it in the water, move the pickup, move the trailer. The motor won't start. He said, "Don't worry about it. I got this covered." He starts tearing into that boat, and he's got pieces all over the boat. Starts putting it back in. He's always got too many pieces left over. 4 hours later, we load it back up. We go back to Alice. Few weeks pass, he calls again. He said, "I've got it figured out. We got it done. I've had just got the boat out of the shop, running like a dream." So we go back down. 5 o'clock, we leave the house, go to Baffin Bay. Get in the boat, boy, it cranks right up. The only problem, anything on that boat that was metal and you touched it, it's gonna shock you. Plus, there was a little problem in the steering mechanism, and it would only turn left. Now, try to get away from the boat dock, and you can only turn left. Food was a big deal to Spike, as all of you know that ever made many trips with him or ate with him. I find out years later from Tracy Saul that all of our pregame meals, or any time we were eating as a team, whether on a road trip or at the dining hall, it got to be such a joke that they had a pot up. They'd put a dollar in a pot, and Spike had a habit of going around and visiting with all the players. He'd get a piece of bacon off Anthony Lynn's plate. He'd get a biscuit off of Tracy Saul's plate. So they had this pot up. Whoever he picked the food up off first won the pot. Found that out much later. Of course, he had to have a giant can or container of pepper. He's going to cover everything in pepper and a thick layer. But he also introduced me to some of the best hole-in-the-wall restaurants in the state of Texas, including Mary's in Strong. If you haven't tried it, you need to try it. Well, food brings on the word diet. He was always on some kind of diet. After he got to the University of Texas, I was over in Belleville, so we, some occasion, took us over to Austin, and I went up to the coach's office, went to his office. He was not in his office, so I walked down the hall. I see Emory Ballard in his office, so he invites me in. We have a nice talk, and finally in the conversation, I said, "Coach Ballard, how is Spike doing with his diet?" He said, "The word diet is the loosest word in his vocabulary. So anyway, he's recruiting out of Texas, and he's recruiting a player in Childress. So he flies into Lubbock, he goes by Friendship High School, he picks up his old buddy, Jack Terrian, who was the head coach at Friendship. Come go with me, we're going to Childress, ride with me. So in the conversation from Friendship over to the east side of Lubbock, he's telling him, I'm on a new diet, I'm on the Baby Ruth diet. He said, okay, tell me how that works. He said, well, I eat one Baby Ruth a day, and that's all I eat. Jack said, fine. So they stop in Idaloo at the convenience store, and Spike comes out with a big bag of Baby Ruths. You know where this is going. Before they get to Childress, he'd finished the whole bag of Baby Ruths. He gets to Alice. Of course, that's the first time he had coached and been in that South Texas area, so he had access to all the valley's fruits and vegetables. So one of his cohorts, Gerald Lloyd, that coached for him, decided they were going to go on this grapefruit diet. Had grapefruits, only grapefruits. Of course, after eating grapefruits for several days, the acid in there, they had sores all in their mouth. So that was a loose word. Fashion. You know where this is going, too, don't you? All right, so he's coaching in New Mexico. I'm coaching in Pearland, Texas. So we had some pretty good linemen at that time. So he decides he's going to recruit two of our linemen. So he flies from Albuquerque into Houston, Hobby. He goes by and picks up two or three big cartons of Bluebell ice cream. And here he comes to stay at the house while he recruits these players. So he excuses himself to go get ready for the home visit, and he comes out to get Shirley's okay on what he's wearing, and she said, no, you cannot wear that outfit. So between his clothes and mine, we get him dressed for those home visits. Okay, fast forward to when he's coaching at Tech, and we're recruiting some players in Houston. Jack Terrian is recruiting some players in Houston, and so he flies into Hobby. Jack picks him up, takes him to the hotel to get him dressed for these home visits. Same situation. He goes in the bathroom, gets ready, comes out in like green pants and a brown blazer. Jack says, no, you're not doing that. So between Jack's clothes and Spike's clothes, he gets him presentable, and Spike looks over at Jack. He says, are you going to get ready and go? He said, if you think I'm going and wearing those clothes of yours, you're crazy. Yeah. He was a great public speaker, as you all know. He spoke all over the United States. But the best one I can ever remember, he took me with him to speak at San Antonio High School banquet. So I'm sitting next to him, he gets up at the podium, and he pulls out a little sheet of paper about the size of a matchbox here, and he had told me he was going to speak on the word champions. Each letter, C for commitment, H for honor, and on and on. So about halfway through, he drops this piece of paper, and all it's got on is champion. He misspelled champion so bad. Which brings us to the modern technology. Somehow skipped over this boy. He called Facebook Spacebook. He had a old-timey flip phone. He had probably over 300 calls in there. He had no idea how to get to them. He never did the email thing. He still wanted to talk to you, or if he did talk to you and he left, he wrote you a note. Hey, great to see you. Let's do it again sometime. Come see me soon. Love, Spike. He still did that. Generosity, I'm about through. Generosity. First time I saw the great example of that, we go to Albuquerque for Rick and Shelley's wedding. Okay, after the wedding, we're at the reception. William Taylor spent a little bit too much time around the punch bowl. So he grabs Rick around the neck and he tells him, I am so proud of you. You've married a beautiful girl. I'm so proud of you. This honeymoon is on me. You take care of the whole thing. He sticks this card in his pocket. The next day, after Rick and Shelley had gone up to Santa Fe, stayed in a 5-star hotel, you know, had breakfast, I'm sure the fanciest breakfast they had, no problem, Dad's got this. He gets downstairs ready to pay out, pulls that card out, it's a Shamrock gas card. I've got 100 of them, but I don't have time to tell you. But I know all of you do. If you interacted with him, he made life more fun for you, made your life better. And I'm glad Preacher had all of the hands go up for people that worked for him, people that played for him. If you don't think he touched lives in the correct way, you look at all the ex-players and their families and the beautiful children that they have and the successes that they have made in their lives, like Anthony Lynn. I've got a new team to pull for in the NFL. But he touched those lives so many ways, and we'll always remember that. And thank you to the Dykes family for sharing your dad and your mom with us. Thank you.
Well, I had a cheat sheet so that I wouldn't forget anything, but then I thought, I never saw Coach Dykes talk to anybody with a cheat sheet, so I threw it away. So I'm gonna shoot from the hip like he would, okay? You know, coming out here from San Diego, I'm on the plane and a flight attendant's talking to me, and she's just talking, and you know, my organization got me a seat in first class, so she was working in the back, and she left the people in the back and came up and sat with me, and she's talking about Coach Dykes the whole time. And I said, are you from Lubbock? She said, no. Did you go to Texas Tech? No. And she just know Coach Dykes. And it's just amazing the people's lives that he touched outside of football. And then she asked me if I had his autograph. And I said, oh, I got his phone number. I mean, is that, you know? He was just coach to me, you know, and he was coach to a lot of you out there. And some of us, he was even a father figure to, like myself. And that's just kind of how we knew him. And, you know, and looking back, I can see the things that I may have taken for granted when I had him, okay? Because he was a great man and a great coach, but even a better man. And I don't use the word great a lot, people. You know, I tell my kids all the time, they say, Dad, that was great. I don't know. You need to know the difference between great and good. I don't want to confuse the two, okay? I had a coach in my staff last week. We were looking at college kids getting ready for the draft. And he goes, that was a great catch. I'm like, was it a good catch or a great catch? Because, see, great, that's something that happens every once in a while. That's extraordinary. You know, don't confuse that with good. Great is something different. And when I talk about Coach Dykes, that man was great. You know, and sometimes I just think that's not even a big enough word. I'm trying not to get kicked out. Yeah, we talked just a couple weeks ago. And he never wants to take any credit, you know, and that was one of the things. I mean, he was so humble. And, Coach, I appreciate you really helping me with this, helping me with that. Nah, you was going to do that anyway. Nah, it wasn't me. I had nothing to do. If I wasn't in the church, I would have said something else. But he had everything to do with that. But he never wanted to take any credit for anything. And I was just the most humble guy in the world. And the life lessons that he taught us as players was unbelievable. And I'm just gonna talk about a couple of those. I don't have any jokes, anything like that. That was Coach Park, I left it up to him. He could have kept rolling for me. I was getting into it. But, you know, I think sometimes the genius in Coach Dykes was his simplicity. his ability to break things down, complicated things down, and just make it real simple and plain. And the man had more common sense than you can shake a stick at, okay? I remember he called us up one time after practice, and we all took a knee, and he said, what are you good for? And we all looked like, what? Hey, what are you good for? What do you stand for? Because if you're not good for something, then that means you're good for nothing. And America needs productive people. You need to be productive in something and good for something. And you know, to this day, I ask myself that question. Just last month, I'm sitting in my office, I'm watching tape, I'm organizing things, I'm making decisions, I'm getting ready for the draft, getting ready for OTAs, mini camps, and I'm so busy in my life that I had to stop. Now, what are you good for, Anthony? You know, good Lord didn't put you in this position to not be a productive human being, to not change people's lives, to not affect people, to not be a blessing to somebody. This thing is bigger than just football. And that started with Spike. And I ask myself that all the time. And what I've learned is that questions can be powerful. When you ask the right questions, sometimes that can create movement. That can create moments that you never would have created. And I find myself, after I ask myself these questions, what are you good for? What are you doing? What's making you productive? Shortly after that, I'm doing something that's productive. Like building a roof on top of Habitat Humanity, helping someone build a house. Like pulling over on the side of a road at a 7-Eleven on a conference call with a group of men in the hills in California that's just there meeting, trying to grow as men, you know? But if I don't stop and ask myself those questions, I never get to those moments. And Coach Dykes just pulled us up after practice one day and just, you know, just asked us that. And that stuck with me for the rest, and that'll be with me for the rest of my life. And I noticed the older I get, the more I ask myself that, because I know I'm 48 years old. I got more days behind me than in front of me. Okay? And when I leave her, I want to be like him. I want to be someone that stood for something. I want to be somebody that was a blessing to somebody. And that's what he was for so many of us athletes that are here today. He was a blessing for us. You know, I remember I came in the locker room one day, and there was a group of guys, and I've seen that posse together before. And I walked in, they walked over to him, and they said, Captain, you got to go talk to Coach Dykes. I go, why? And he goes, he's not letting so-and-so play. Why? He missed two study halls. Study hall? Not class. You know, he didn't flunk any classes or anything like that. He missed two study halls. And we're getting ready to play a pretty big game, and we need this player. So I said, all right, this will be an easy one. So I go upstairs, and I talk to Coach Dykes. And I said, Coach Dykes, we got to, I know what you're trying to do. I know you mean well, but you need to let this guy play. We need him. And he goes, well, he missed two study halls, Anthony. I said, well, Coach, I know that was a rule, but well, we really need him this week. Set him down next week. We need him this week. We got to let him play. And I said, and it wasn't class anyway, study hall, Coach. He goes, where were you when I was in his house and I was talking to his mama? And I told his mama that I was going to take care of him, that I was going to look out for him. Where were you? I said, well, you got a point there, Coach. You know? And after I realized I wasn't going to change his mind, I went back downstairs and I told the guys, I said, you're not playing. You knew the standard. So, you knew the standard. You knew the expectations. You didn't do it. You're not playing. And the guy was like, oh, my goodness, I missed study hall. Who does he think he is? My daddy? I said, yep. Exactly. And that's what he was. I mean, he was a father for us, especially for me at that time in my life, because I grew up in a single-parent home. My mother was a powerful woman. She worked two jobs. She never asked me any help. She took care of me and my sister. And sometimes things got hard, you know? It got really hard. And, you know, like Christmas missed us every now and then. You know, we talk about the Christmas spirit, and we didn't open no presents. And so every time things got hard, I'd always blame it on not having a father. And one day my mom told me, I was 9 years old, she said, you have a father, his first name Jesus, his last name Christ. And when you need something, you go to him. And when you need advice, you talk to him. And when you're hurt, you talk to him. And I still do to this day. But I also believe that God put people in my life at certain times, father figures, people that I can reach out and touch, talk to and hug, disappoint and make happy. He put those people in my life, and one of those people was Spike Dykes, no doubt about it. And I realize that more today, now, than ever before. The last thing I say is, I'm in New York City, And I interviewed for a job with the Miami Dolphins in 2015. 2014, the Jets. 2015, the Miami Dolphins. And San Francisco 49ers. And I thought I was going to get one of those jobs. And Coach Dykes and I talked a little bit. And I thought I was going to get one of those jobs. And I didn't get it, and I was very disappointed. And my agent wanted to send me to this company on Wall Street that helps you prepare for interviews. Basically, you sit down with these billionaire owners, and they have their CEOs, CFOs, CIOs, I mean, all these CEOs, I don't even know what they mean. And you sit down with all these people, and they're trying to get you to relate to these people, okay? Because they're not going to hire you if they don't know you, if they can't relate to you. And so that I'm sitting there, and I'm doing this training, and I'm supposed to train for a week and then do 2 mock interviews with them, and that was the whole curriculum. And after about 30 minutes, I got up and went to the bathroom, and I said, I can't do this. They're trying to tell me what the world, how to act, what to say, and I called my agent and say, I'm out. And I said, I appreciate you guys very much, but this is not helping me. Basically, you're telling me I can't be myself, and I don't feel comfortable with that. And I walked out, and I'm walking down the street in New York City, and all these people walking everywhere, and I'm just walking, and I'm just thinking to myself, why do you want to be a head coach? And I go back to my Pop Warner days, all the coaches I had in junior high school, and I get those college coaches. And I think about all my college coaches. Then I get to Coach Dykes, and I remember what he told me. When I retired from the Denver Broncos in 1999, I had 2 weeks to decide if I was going to be a coach or not. Mike Shanahan gave me a 4-year contract and said, you got 2 weeks to sign it. I drove from Denver to Lubbock, and the first time I seen a game in years, and I sat in Coach Dykes' office, and I talked to him, and I said, Coach, I need some advice here. I need to know about this coaching gig that you're in. And he told me every negative thing about coaching. And he said, I thought you were smarter than that. You want to coach? I was like, and he said, I'm going to go to the restroom, and if I'm you, I would run. As fast as you can, I would run. And he goes, if you still want to coach, then be here when I get back. He came back, and I was still there. And he goes, okay, you got a great opportunity in front of you. He goes, I'm going to tell you this right here. Football is a relationship business. It's not a bottom line business. Football is about relating to people, communicating with people, and serving. Relating, commuting, and serving. That's what he said, those 3 things. And then he got up and he walked out. And I was sitting there expecting this philosophy and philosophical talk, and oh, it was over, done. And I'm walking down the street in New York City, and that hits me. Relate, communicate, and serve. Relate, communicate, and serve. And I went back and I looked at all my interview information, my discipline policy, my media policy, my player relations policy, and I made everything around relate, communicate, and serve. The very next year, I interviewed 3 jobs, and I was offered 2. I didn't need the firm. I didn't need it, you know. The Wall Street company, they didn't have the sauce. Coach Dykes had the sauce. He had it all along. And a lot of those lessons that he taught us back then that was so simple, and it's just a way of life, and it still works today. And he's been a blessing for me. I know he's been a blessing for a lot of you, and I really want to celebrate his life. You know, I don't want to be sad today. I want to celebrate, because we were in front of greatness, people. Don't get that confused with good. We use good all the time. No, he was great, extraordinary. Every once in a while, maybe never again, okay? That was my coach, Spike Dykes. Rest in peace.
Yes, I'm wearing red and black. Only for my friend. Would I do that? When the family asked me about coming to speak, they said he'll probably have a smile on his face when I come to Lubbock, Texas to speak. And I'm sure he does. I've had some bad days in Lubbock. You all really enjoyed them, may I say. One of them was the first year that I coached at Texas, and I kept hearing how hard it was to play in Lubbock. I couldn't figure it out. Then I started looking at Coach's record against Texas, and Craig's right. He'd beaten Texas more than Texas had beaten him. He'd beaten Texas A&M more than Texas A&M had beaten him. And then I come out and recruit in the spring. I'm going through the high schools, and all the high school coaches were really nice, and I said, Coach, we love you, and We're going to take care of you, but you're number two. Long as Spike's coaching, coach, he gets all of our players. That's what they all said. So I got my eyes open very quickly. I came to Lubbock for the first time. I know it's a tough place to play, but I'm not sure why. I meet him in pregame. My brother Watson knew him because he coached at Rice, and I've been around Coach some at conference meetings, but didn't know him that well. And I walk up to him. He said, "Hey, boy, how you doing?" I said, "I'm doing good, Coach. How are you?" And he said, "Fine, fine." He said, "You know, my little boys aren't very good." So I'm really worried about the game. You got good-looking guys, my little guys. I look down there and see Montre Weber or Rager. Guy's a great pro player. I see Gray. I see their Ricky Williams. I see these great-looking players. And he's got that tobacco, and he's wiping his mouth. And I know I'm about to get whipped good. So I feel like, okay, we're going to hang in here and fight. And then the officials come out, and they say, "Coach Brown, how are you? Welcome to the Big 12. And I said, "Hey, guys." And I introduced myself, and each one gave him. And then they turned to Spike and hugged him first. "Boy, Spike, you got a good team. Boy, we love watching you practice and stuff. You know it's a..." And Sharon's apple pie, oh, my God. So I knew we were in trouble. And then there's an onside kick late in the game, and I swear to God, the official on our sideline said, "Spike's ball." So I knew it wasn't easy. Next year he comes to Austin, he walks out, and he, you know, "Oh boy, my little old boy's got Cliff at quarterback as a freshman." He said, "My little old boy." I said, "Coach, don't go there again. I can't do it. You whipped us last year. Just don't go there, Coach." "I know, you know, oh boy." He said, I'm going to promise you something, though, son. I'm going to promise you something. I said, "What's that, Coach?" He said, "You're going to beat the hell out of us tonight. You're going to beat the hell out of us." After the game, we won by a big score, and he came over and said, "Kept my promise. Kept my promise." He made me laugh more than anybody I've ever been around. And he's so much fun just to be around. So he quits coaching. I said, "Why'd you quit? It's important for me to know why you quit. I'm getting a little older." And he said, "Oh, it's easy." He said, "They told me you lose 10% of your support when you're coaching every year. I coached 13 years at Tech. Hell, you do the math." Made sense. Made sense. Then I said, "What do you do in retirement?" I said, "I don't do nothing. And that don't start till noon." So we're playing golf last summer in the North Carolina mountains. R.C. Slocum, who he beat a lot. Me, who he beat. And the Lost Dots. And by then, we're not doing very well with the lungs. So the first thing I said, "Tell me, what's wrong with your lungs?" And he said, "Well, guys that can breathe good, kind of their lungs do this." He said, "Mine do this." And he said, "I can't breathe very good." So we go play golf. And I'm worried about him. We're all worried about him. We're driving up on greens. We're driving up on tee boxes, and he's mad at us. And then when he has to walk 5 yards, he goes down on a knee, puts his head down, and I said, "Coach, we need to quit. Ain't quit nothing my whole life, not quitting this." I said, "We need to quit." Next hole, drive up, hits the ball, goes down to a knee, got his head down. We think he's going to die. So I said, "Coach, we got to quit." "Ain't quitting. Ain't quitting." Next hole, gets down on the knee, and I said, "Okay, I've had it." I said, "I think you're probably going to die right here on our golf course." And he's got that tobacco all over his mouth. He's got it on his shirt. And I said, "And I'm going to be honest with you, I'm not going to do mouth to mouth when you go down." He looked at me and said, he raised his head and said, "I'd rather die." "I'd rather die." He was so much fun. When you get around him and talk to him, and he took complicated things and made them very simple. Last week, I had lunch with him for about 2 hours, and then we stayed outside at the Blue Bonnet in Marble Falls for about another hour and a half, and everybody in there came up to say hello to Coach, everybody. And I swear, if he didn't know who they were, he made them think he did. And he knew something about them, or he said something that made them feel good. They just lighten up. So I got home that night, and he called me and said, that was a fun lunch. Thanks for taking me to lunch. But I got to apologize to you. I said, why, Coach? He said, everybody in there is licking you clean. He said, they were all coming up talking to you the whole day, and I didn't mean for you to come up there and have to hold a church service. So we decided that he needed to get back to play golf. And Rick knows this, because the other night we were talking to him about we're going to get him an oxygen mask to play golf. So he didn't get on the internet, so I got Sally to get on the internet. We found him an oxygen mask that he can put a bag on his hip, and he can go play golf and have fun. And I said, well, Coach, it doesn't look very pretty now. He said, hell, I ain't looked pretty for 79 years. I ain't worried about looking pretty. I want to hit some golf balls. So, and then you think about, he was the most honest man I've ever met. He's the most generous man I ever met. He was the most loyal human being. He would get in fights over me with me sitting there. And I'd say, Coach, leave it alone. I ain't going to do it. I ain't going to do it. They're wrong, Coach. They're wrong. And then when you call his house today, after 6.5 to 7 years that Sharon was gone, and as we know, more years than that, that she couldn't communicate with Coach, he left on his voicemail, Sharon and I aren't here right now. Leave a message. And I wonder how many of us as husbands would be able to be that loyal to their spouse 6.5 years later. I love him. I miss him. As Anthony said, his legacy is about people. It's about truth. It's about family. He loved his family. And it was about loyalty at a time where people aren't as loyal. And what we've lost in Coach, we've lost a dear friend, but we've lost an icon. There aren't many Coach Spike Dykes left, because he said exactly what he wanted to say anytime he wanted to say it, and he didn't even understand what the words politically correct meant or care at all. And the last story I'm going to tell you before I sit down is he was at Alice coaching, and Emory Ballard was at Texas, and Emory was supposed to get the job at Baylor. And Coach Ballard was going to call, he thought, and hire Spike at Baylor. So the next day, Coach Ballard gets the job at Texas A&M. And Spike decides he needs a haircut, but he tells his assistant, somebody's going to call, and when they call, just get a number, and I'll call them back. He thought Emory was going to hire him at Texas A&M, since he took the Texas A&M job instead of the Baylor job. So he gets back, said, somebody call, and the young assistant said, yeah. Said, who was it? Said, I don't know, I just took the number. So he didn't have any idea who it was. So he called, and the guy on the other end of the phone said, this is Darryl Royal, who is this? Spike said, John Wayne. Darryl Royal wasn't going to be calling him. And then to close, Coach Royal said, this is Darryl Royal. Who is this? He said, oh, my God, it's really Darryl Royal. Coach Royal said, I want you to come. I want you to coach for me. You want to come? Spike said, I need to talk to Sharon. He said, fine, I'll call you later. He goes to talk to Sharon and says, Coach Royal called me and offered me a job. She said, that's good. What are you going to coach? He said, you know, he never mentioned it. Well, how much money are you going to make? You know, honey, he never mentioned that either. And she said, you want to go, don't you? And he said, I'm at Alice High School. Of course I want to go. So Mike Campbell called about 30 minutes later and said, what are you doing? He said, I'm talking to Sharon. He said, it's been 45 minutes. You better take that job, boy, or you'll be at Alice the rest of your damn life. I said, what'd you do? He said, I took that job. And I said, when do you want me there? I'm about 3 hours away. So thank you all.
Amen. I'm going to ask you to take the hymnal in front of you and turn to hymn number 504. There's something real powerful about this old hymn, because this was one that Spike really, really appreciates. And let's stand together and join in these words of faith.
Please be seated. If we are fortunate enough, there will be a time in our life when we encounter someone who will leave an indelible mark on us, someone who knows how to serve rather than be served, someone who will initiate love rather than waiting to be loved. This was Spike Dykes. And boy, did he love well. His life was filled with, as C.S. Lewis puts it, the grime and glory of living out his journey of faith in Christ. He was defined by his God, his faith, his love for people, in his grand, grand love for his wife, his children, his grandchildren, and his great-grandchildren. Rick and Shelley, BB and Larry, Sonny and Kate, you are Spike's greatest legacy. Jessica and Mark, Julie, Dusty, Casey, Taylor and Taylor, Allie and Charlie, you are the apples of his eye. And one day, Daniel and Lucy, Swede and Bear. They will have the full knowledge of this great man's immense love for each of them. Each of you is family to me. And each of you is his legacy, and you carry his hope. You carry his laughter, his benevolence, his kindness and love deep inside of you. I see it, and I have seen it for years, and for that I am grateful. Would you join me in prayer? God of abundance and mercy, we give you thanks for your eternal and unwavering love. We thank you for your healing presence and our celebration of the life of Coach. And Father, I pray that in the days, weeks, and months to come that you would draw near to this great family. Father, I've read story after story, heard countless appreciative Lubbock citizens speak with such fondness. And I've sat in quiet moments with Spike's children and grandchildren over the years and listened to them talk about the character of this beloved man. And Father, what I do not take lightly is that the stories that are told not only speak to the character of Spike, but they speak to the character of Jesus. Jesus loves without condition or compromise and beckons us to come to him as we are, not as we should be. Coach loved like that. He loved his children like that. His grandchildren he loved like that. And because of this man's legacy of faith, hope, kindness, laughter, and love, so too his family carries that same mantle. And Lord, when I am around them, in the many ways they demonstrate love, my faith in you is deepened and refreshed. I pray that in the weeks, months, and years to come, when darkness, dryness, or doubt seems to be swirling all around, that each member of his family would hear Coach's words for them ringing in their ears. You matter. You are worth it. You have what it takes. You belong to me. And I am crazy about you. I pray that in each of them, that they would know in those same moments that those two are your words for them, dear Father. You matter. You are worth it. You have what it takes. You belong to me, and I am crazy about you. Father, we love you and we need you. May we move in grace with one another. May we be quick to reconcile and forgive. Father, may we seek your face, your wisdom, and your guidance. Continue to remind us that you are still on the throne and that you have us in the palm of your mighty hand. We pray all of these things in the very strong name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Glenn. I know what it's like to be a couple of touchdowns down with only a minute or so left. And so I also know how to shorten a sermon and get the message out today. And here's what I really think we need to hear, because you've heard exactly what we need to hear, amen? And I think these things need to be said. First of all, a practical message. Number one, grieve well. We grieve what we lost. And when we lose something, we feel it. But sometimes we stuff those feelings and we don't know what we've lost. We haven't paid attention or we haven't done the hard work to figure out what we've lost. But when we put our finger on it, we feel it. And so with Coach, I think he would want us to do the discipline, put your finger on it, work through it, feel it. But once you feel it, give thanks. Let's give thanks to God for how Spike Dykes has been a part of our lives. I think that's a healthy process. Grieve well. Number two, Spike was a servant. In fact, all of the Spike-isms, we could probably do a whole service with those and get creative, especially like the one about the rented donkey. I think that's a really good one. But I think that Jesus had some Spike-isms. And one that I'm fond of is, if you want to be great, then be a servant. And Spike Dykes was a servant. Now, I know he didn't give off the image of a servant, but here's how he served you. His passion, and growing up in a coach's house and in a field house myself, I know this. His passion was to make sure you guys succeeded. That was his passion. That was his purpose. Your success, and you heard it in the testimonies a moment ago, your success is what he's given his life for. And so use that well. He was a servant in that way. And another way he was a servant is he was a connector. He was a networker. He brought you together in so many different circles. And today he's still doing it. He's got us together. He served in some very special ways. The last one is this, that he was always learning. He was always taking things in. When he lost, he would learn. Even his first coaching job, we got fired. He said he learned, and he was learning up until the end. Even the kids share with me how he was still learning how to be a good dad and granddad. I think that was huge. And so we need to hear those messages. Grieve well. Be a servant. And keep on learning, because Jesus recruited 12 players, by the way. 11 out of the 12 are good, but that's enough to field an offense. And Jesus changed the world with those. He's calling us to similarly always be learning and always be passing on what we've learned, and that's Spike Dykes. I want to invite you to pray with me before we sing a song about grace. And in that grace, I want you to be a recipient of his grace and begin to see where you can be able to share that in your circle. Would you pray? God, thank you for this life. Thank you for this hour. Thank you for this family and these words that we get to weave together as a part of your healing in our lives. Now, pour out your grace on us so that we can put into perspective what our mission is as we leave this place. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. It's hymn number 378. You probably know it, but we're going to stand together and we're going to sing. may be seated. Here's how we're going to bring this service to a close. As I prepare to give our benediction, I want you to know that we're going to recess the family out, back out to the front of the sanctuary, and they're going to be taken straight over to the USA for a reception that follows, and you are invited to be a part of that. And I want you to stay in place until I dismiss the congregation, and then we will be able to leave and find our vehicles and meet them. They want to greet you there. The reason that we have so much overflow is that Spike didn't want anybody to be excluded, and they want to also be have time to be able to greet you there, because it's so important for them to touch in every life and be able to celebrate your being with them today. I talked to Jim Jackson, who was the pastor when they were here, and Jim went on and on about how Spike was just so genuine, so authentic of a person, and that even when he was losing, Spike and Sharon would be sitting right back there. You guys in the back on the left are in their chair, by the way, and he said they would sit right back there, and that Spike was just like clockwork to come and be in this place. Sharon would, she soaked in the music. And so we're gonna close asking the choir to lead us in an anthem, and we're gonna sit and soak it in ourselves and allow her presence, her passion, and allow Coach's commitment to begin to fuel us on our mission as we go. Would you pray with me? God, now we face this time to be able to walk out of this room to begin to work on the connections, the relationships, the commitments that we have, to begin to see how we can be servants, to grieve well with your Spirit's help, and to go learn and be a disciple of yours and of what love can do in this world. Now, lead us in that mission. In your name we pray. Amen.